Let us pray. Father, we thank you for another session of fellowship and study together tonight. We thank you for the love of your people to study your word. A Christian without the study of the word will be like a straw for a backbone, will not be able to stand. We pray that as we come week after week, you strengthen every one of us and you change and transform our lives in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We welcome you to the study of tonight in Jesus' name. We're still in our study of the Epistle of James, and I believe that the Lord is already transforming and touching our lives, especially our tongue. The writer of this epistle is concerned about the character of the true believer. And in this chapter, he takes up the tongue because the tongue occupies a central position of importance in the life of the believer. He's telling us that whatever confession we make, whatever profession of the Christian faith we're making, if we do not control our tongue, our testimony will be vain and deceptive. In the passage we're looking at today, he's looking at the natural man, the unregenerated man, the unsaved man, and he's talking of the difficulty of taming his tongue. He likens the tongue to a fierce, uncontrollable, dangerous element in the body. Please look at James chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. It says, "For every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea, is tamed, and has been tamed of mankind." In verse 8, "But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison." We ourselves, we have the experience from ourselves, our personal lives, and the people around us. It talks of the tongue as an unruly evil, uncontrollable evil. And it says it is full of deadly poison. Obviously, the apostle must have been thinking of the lying tongue that is full of deceit and falsehood. He might have been thinking of the reviling tongue that will belittle other people, make fun of other people, despise other people. He might be talking about the foul tongue, which becomes the channel of all impurities and uncleanness. What shall we say of the passionate angry tongue that hastens to give voice to anger and to hatred? And then you find that in mischief, it begins to throw about all kind of words that will hurt other people and make a damage that is irreparable in the lives of neighbors. And there are some people that appear to be clever, and they are sarcastic in their tongue, and they put contempt on other people because they are proud. How about the people that use their tongue and they are just abusive, insulting, loud and harsh, and they use painful cutting words like razor blade upon other people? And of course there are slanderers, and there are people that are talkatives as well. That's why the apostle, as he looks around him and he looks at many people, he says, look at the tongue. It's full of deadly poison. It's an unruly, uncontrollable, unmanageable evil, and nobody can tame it by himself. And except we surrender that tongue to the Lord, we too will not be able to control the tongue. Let's look at 3 points in our study of today. Number one, the powerlessness of man to tame the tongue. Number two, the poison and the peril of the untamed tongue. But thank God there's a solution in the hand of God. And I'm praying that you will find that solution in the Lord in Jesus' name. That's point three, the power of divine touch on the tongue. We go to number one, the powerlessness of man to tame the tongue. As you look at man, you are surprised at the wisdom and the power of man. Man is a marvelous creature outside. It is only when he comes home, when he is by himself, he becomes a wretched man, a mischievous man, an uncontrollable man. He tries to control everything on land, everything in the sky, everything in the sea, but the thing, the tongue that is a member of his own body, that he cannot control. That's why the writer makes the observation in verse 7. He says in verse 7, "For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea, is tamed, and has been tamed of mankind." If you look at that verse very well, it talks of the animals on land, it talks of the birds flying in the air, it talks of the reptile that is crawling on the ground, And he talks of the fish in the sea. It's like he's looking at the whole universe, at the whole creation of God, and the things that have breath and life. And he says, look at man very well. That man is so mighty and powerful outside his own domain. He can control virtually everything. Actually, that's the dominion that God gave unto man originally. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over everything, every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And you see, even after the fall, man did not lose that authority, and that dominion, and that power. Look at Psalm 8 and verse 6. In Psalm 8 verse 6, many years after the fall of man, we still see the authority and the dominion of man. The psalmist says, thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hand, and thou hast put all things under his feet. And then he tells us the category of things that are under his feet, or that man has dominion over. In verse 7, all sheep and oxen ye, and the beasts of the field. And then he goes into verse 8, the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the parts of the seas. That confirms exactly what James had said, that man is able to control, is able to dominate, and is able to bring under his power everything on land, everything in the sea, everything in the sky. And yet there is a little member in his own body, very small in comparison with all the things that man is controlling. And man has no power, he has no might, he does not know what to do to control that small member of the body. That's why James is telling us in chapter 3, the first part of verse 8, but the tongue can no man tame. Why is it man cannot tame the tongue? Because actually there is a connection between the heart and the tongue. If man cannot change the heart, he cannot control the tongue. And in fact, men are not even willing to control their tongue. And many people are not willing to bring that tongue under the control of the Lord himself. There are many parts of the Bible that tells us that. Let's just look at a few in Psalm 12, for example. Psalm 12, reading from verses 3 and 4. It says, the Lord shall cut off flattering lips, and the tongue that speaketh proud things. And see the way man is talking about his tongue in verse 4. Who has said, with our tongue we will prevail. Our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? Obviously, the people talking like this, they do not know the Lord. When we are born again, we recognize Jesus as our Savior, as Lord over us. When we are born again, we know that we do not belong to ourselves. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. When we are born again, we know that we are going to walk in the way of God. We are going to be submissive to the word of God. But hear what these unbelievers are saying. With our tongue, we are going to prevail. Our lips, our mouth, our tongue is our own. They said, who is Lord over us? That's why they are not able to control that tongue. They have not accepted the authority of the Lord over them. And they do not allow the word of God to dictate to them what they will say and what they will not say. In Psalm 5 verse 9. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. They flatter with their tongue. You see, the tongue is just an instrument. If there is wickedness in the heart, if there is unfaithfulness in the life, if the heart does not want to think of any good thing, the tongue will not be able to perform well. In Psalm 120, from verses 3 and 4. Psalm 120, verses 3 and 4. It says, what shall be given unto thee, or what shall be done unto thee, thou false tongue? Sharp arrows of the mighty with coals of juniper. He's still telling us what James had been telling us, that this tongue is uncontrollable. It's like arrows in the hand of the mighty. And if that mighty man is not a controlled man, is not a sensible man, he can do a lot of damage, dangerous things with that arrow. Conflict in the family is the result of the use of the tongue. Confusion in society is because of the use of the tongue. Problem in the church, local church, or any district church is because of the use of the tongue. Even wars and battles in life is because of the use of the tongue. And all the conflict and all the battle and all the wars we see around, we hear about, shows us that man is not capable of controlling his tongue. In Matthew chapter 12, reading from verse 34. It says, "So generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh." He was talking to the religious people, the Jews. He said, "You are just a generation of vipers. There is a poison within. There is a sting in the tail. There is something dangerous and deadly in the system of the unrighteous and the unsafe fellow." He said, "How can you? That is, it's so impossible. How will you be able to do it? Because you are evil inside, being evil through and through. How can you speak good things? Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh." That's why you find that man may be able to control the crocodiles and the whales and the lion and the tiger and the elephant and quite a lot of other things, but he cannot control that little member, the tongue. In Jeremiah chapter 9 verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 9 verse 5. He said, "They will deceive everyone his neighbor and will not speak the truth. They have taught their tongue to speak lies and weary themselves to commit iniquity." He said, "They have taught their tongues to speak lies, and they don't know how to reverse the evil thing that is in their lives already." It's only when you get saved, or when we get saved, a change, a transformation will come. No matter how educated a man may be, he needs the controlling power of the Lord before he can tame the tongue. Let's come back to James now, chapter 3, verse 8. James chapter 3, verse 8. He says, "But the tongue." You know, he's making a comparison when he said something in verse 7. And now when he comes to verse 8, he says, "But the tongue." Verse 7, "Every kind of beast have been tamed, but the tongue." Even those heavy, great birds flying in the sky, they have been tamed, but the tongue. Even serpents that are poisonous, even serpents that people will run away from, there are men that have known how to charm, how to tame, how to control, how to direct those serpents. But the tongue, even the crocodile in the sea that is so dangerous and so wild, men have been able to tame. In fact, they can make the crocodile to do something to entertain men, and they put some of them in the zoo. But the tongue, in verse 8, "But the tongue can no man tame." Now, it tells us in the latter part of that verse 8, "It is unruly evil, full of deadly poison." As we are talking about the tongue, I want you to look at your own tongue. The way you use it with your friends and neighbors. The way you use it with your wife, with your husband. What contribution your tongue is making in the lives of your children. And what is your tongue doing in your place of work too? Is it under control? Or is it full of evil? Is it full of deadly poison? That leads us to point number 2. The poison and the peril of the untamed tongue. Here James is telling us something. He tells us, number 1, the untamed tongue, number 1, is evil. Number 2, it's an unruly evil, uncontrollable evil, unmanageable evil. Number 3, it is full of poison. Not only poison now. Number 4, it is full of deadly, dangerous poison. When we say something is evil, it is bad enough. But now the Bible says it's an unruly evil. It can hurt and it can destroy more than any part of the body. You understand? A sword in the hand of somebody cannot hurt somebody who is absent. But the tongue can hurt somebody who is absent. If a man, for example, will wear something like brass all over and cover himself, a sword will not be able to do anything to him. But the word of an unruly tongue can still pierce that armor and hurt that man. In the passage we studied last week, in verse 6, the apostle compared the tongue with hellfire. When you think about it and you compare the tongue, the fire in the tongue, with the fire of hell, you will even say the fire of the tongue is worse than the fire of hell. How can we say that? Because the fire in hell will only hurt the wicked, will hurt the bad people, will hurt the sinners. But the fire of the tongue will hurt good people and bad people, educated people, sincere people, loving people. The tongue can hurt anybody. The tongue does not spare anyone, good or bad. Let's go back to Psalms again. In Psalm 57, reading from verse 4, we're looking at the evil of the tongue. We're looking at the poison and the peril in the tongue. When you look at the bad things, the evil things, the dangerous things that the tongue can do, it will make you to go to the Lord in prayer. It will make me to go to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, except you control this tongue for me, except you control this tongue for us, we'll do unmanageable, immeasurable evil in society. In Psalm 57 verse 4, my soul is among the lions, and I lie even among them that are set on fire, even the sons of men, whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue is sharp sword. This man is comparing the tongue of man with the lion, with the sword, with the spear, with the arrow, with the fire. And you know, we make enemies for ourselves through our tongue. If you are more quiet, you'll have more friends. If you are more quiet, your mistakes will be reduced. If you are more quiet, you'll be a blessing to people. It is talking that makes us to ruin and destroy the lives of other people. Oh, people say, I don't know why people are running away from me. It appears they rub something on me that makes everybody to hate me. Nobody wants me around them. It's our tongue. If you become quiet, you'll find that people will be attracted to you. But if every time they visit you, every time they relate with you, there is an arrow, there is a spear, there is a sword, there is a fire that you use in burning them, they'll be running away from you. In Psalm 52, reading from verse 1, thy tongue devises mischief, like a sharp razor walking deceitfully. Thou lovest evil more than good, and lying rather than to speak righteousness. Thou lovest devouring words, O deceitful tongue. There are people that like critical words. They criticize. They are happy when they cut down other people. There are some people, they don't know vocabulary. They want to speak that others will smile, that others will be happy. The only vocabulary they know is the one they will speak like this, and the sorrow in the life of that person will not evaporate, will not leave that soul for about 1 year. In Psalm 59 verse 7. Psalm 59 verse 7, behold, they belch out with their mouth, and swords are in their lips. For who they say, he doth hear. You see, if we say we are Christians, and our words are so sharp, just one sentence we speak, people will never forget. And men and women will be crying in secret because of that thing that you say. What joy do we have in making other people suffer, other people happy? What joy do you have making your wife unhappy, making your husband unhappy by the words of your mouth? Why don't we go to the cross? Why don't we go to Christ and have Christ change everything, and then our lives will be beautiful, our words will be soft and comforting? In Psalm 64 verse 4, Psalm 64, reading it from verse 3. Who wet their tongue like a sword, and bend their bows to shoot their arrow, even bitter words. In verse 4, that they may shoot in secret at the perfect. You see, the people that will use our tongues again, they are not necessarily sinners. In fact, some of them, many of them, are the beloved of the Lord. The sisters love the Lord. The brothers love the Lord. Even though they love the Lord, we're still hurting them with our tongue. I want to show you now the deadly nature of the tongue. The poison, the peril, the danger in the tongue. I want to show you how the tongue can cause death unnecessarily. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 10. 2 Samuel chapter 10 from verse 1. And it came to pass after this that the king of the children of Ammon died, and Anon, his son, reigned in his stead. And then David said, I will show kindness unto Hanon, the son of Nahash, as his father showed kindness unto me. You see here, what David was going to do was a good thing. I want to show you now the tongue of the people around the king. That is the other king that David sent people to. Look at verse 3. And the princes of the children of Amnon said unto Anon, their lord, thinkest thou that David doth honor thy father, that he has sent comforters unto thee? As not David rather sent his servants unto thee to search the city and to spy it out and to overthrow it? Now do you see the tongue here? David was doing a good thing. He sent his people to go and greet this man because his father died. Look at the tongue now, a deadly poison, an unruly poison, unruly evil, full of deadly poison. They called him and they said, do you think David loved you so much and is honoring your father that died? And then he sent these people to you. He is spying your country. He has an evil intention. In verse 4, wherefore Anon took David's servant and shaved off one half of their beard and cut off their garments in the middle, even to the buttocks, and sent them away. Do you see what they led the man to do as a result of the misuse of their tongue? Look at what followed in verse 6. And when the children of Amnon saw that they stank before David, the children of Amnon sent and hired the Syrians of Beth-Rehob and the Syrians of Zobah, 20,000 footmen. Well, they wanted to fight now. Look at verse 8. And the children of Amnon came out and put battle in array at the entering in of the gate. War started. Killing started. Look now at verse 14. And when the children of Amnon saw that the Syrians were fled, then fled they also before Abishai and entered into the city. Look at the result in verse 18. And the Syrians fled before Israel, and David slew the men 700 chariots of the Syrians. That's not the end. And 40,000 horsemen. That's not the end. And he smote Shobab, the captain of the host, who died there. More than 40,000 souls died, and many of them unprepared, not ready for heaven. They went to hell just because of suspicion and some people commenting, do you think David loves you so much and honors your father? Just because of that misuse of the tongue, more than 40,000 people died unprepared. I pray God will control our tongue. That leads us to point number 3 now. And we're talking now about the power of divine touch on the tongue. Thank God, with God all things are possible. What natural man cannot do, our God can do. He can touch and tame our tongue. Once he touches our heart, he transforms our heart, of course our tongue will be transformed. We have that assurance because, don't you know, Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, in the millennial reign, he will tame the wildest of beasts. And today, he can tame the wildest of tongues. In his earthly ministry, he brought the demoniac under control. He will bring us under control. But if that is going to be the case, we have to pray. Look at Isaiah. He's just like one of us. A man called by God. A man that knew God as his own father too. A man that had been running errand for the Lord. He prophesied from chapters 1 to 5. But then when he saw the glory of God in chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6 verse 5. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. The wonderful thing about Isaiah, it was that he was very sincere, he was very frank, and he confessed his condition. If we don't just come to the Bible study and then just hear the word of God and then just go back home and go and be speaking the same way, if tonight we'll do like Isaiah and say, Lord, I know the problem. I know the condition of my tongue. I know the way I talk. I know many people have offended already because of my tongue. Help me. The Lord will help us tonight. In verse 6, then flew one of the seraphim unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, and thy iniquity is taken away, thy sin is purged. He can purge us tonight. He can transform our tongue tonight. He can tame that tongue tonight. In fact, he can pour his grace into our lips. In Psalm 45 verse 2. Psalm 45 verse 2. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured unto thy lips. Therefore God has blessed thee then forever. Although that is talking about the Messiah, but it can be true of the people that are following the Lord as well. Isaiah chapter 50 verse 4. It says, the Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning. He wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned. It's the work of the Lord. If you tell the Lord will do it. And then as you yield to little surrender to him during the day, you talk, you speak as he wants you to speak. You make sure that everything is under the control of the Lord and of the Spirit of the Lord. In Colossians chapter 4 verse 6. Let your speech be always with grace. Don't speak any graceless word. Let your speech, lest your talking, anywhere you find yourself, be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. The Lord can do it for us tonight. Psalm 141 verse 3. It was a prayer of David. It ought to be your prayer and it ought to be my prayer. Because we ourselves, we cannot control the tongue alone. But the Lord can do it and the Lord will do it. Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth and keep the door of my lips. Look back. See all the trouble that you have gone into because of the use of the tongue. See the problem in the family. See how people are running away from you. See how you scattered everything because of your tongue. There is nobody here tonight who will say he has never done something wrong with his tongue. Who will say he has not offended people with his tongue in the past. But a good thing will happen if we take that tongue to the Lord. And we pray sincerely and seriously. O Lord, set a watch before my mouth and keep the door of my lips. Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord? You know how many people have gone into trouble because of the tongue? Remember Miriam and remember Aaron. Remember the wife of David. She became barren for the rest of life because of just one moment of talking unnecessarily. Do you remember Zechariah? When he spoke and then became dumb for the rest, for 9 months. Why don't we come to the Lord and say, I'm fed up with talking in this bad way. Oh Lord, you are going to pour your grace into my mouth, into my lips. Let the heavenly fire come upon my tongue, come upon my heart, and purge away my iniquity and all the wrong way of speaking. Oh Lord, take everything away. Tell the Lord sincerely, tell the Lord seriously. You cannot tame that tongue yourself. I will keep quiet. I will not talk. I will not answer. I will not discuss with anybody. I won't talk to anyone anymore. That's not the answer. The answer is that the grace of God will be in your speech. You have kind words. You have a comforting word. You have loving words. The words like that of Jesus. You'll not hurt anybody with your tongue anymore. You'll help people. Talk to the Lord. He will do it.